This adenoidectomy alone or in combination with tonsillectomy is one of the commonest surgeries done in ENT departments. So under adenoidectomy, I'll explain the indications, contraindications, the procedure including anesthesia, positioning and the steps of surgery, postoperative care and also the complications associated with the adenoidectomy. The anatomy of nasopharynx was already explained in a previous class. And you know that adenoids are otherwise called the Lushka's tonsil. Okay. The synonym is Lushka's tonsil. This can be asked in MCQs. Where is this adenoids located? They are in the nasopharynx. Where in the nasopharynx? At the junction of roof and the posterior wall. If this is the nasopharynx, the nose, the frontal sinus, the middle turbinate, inferior turbinate, palate, axis and the atlas vertebra, isn't it? So, this is the nasopharynx and the adenoids are seen at the junction of roof and the posterior wall of nasopharynx. Okay, so this roof is formed by basis sphenoid and basis occiput and posterior wall is formed by the arch of atlas and also axis vertebra. Okay, so it is seen here and if you look from anterior part, so coina, posterior end of septum, middle turbinate, inferior turbinate, both sides, and the eustachian opening, soft palate, and here the adenoids are situated at here. If you see it like this, so this adenoids are relatively absent at birth, and they are radiologically visible by 4 to 6 months of age in all infants. Physiological enlargement occurs at the ages of 2 to 7 years, getting a maximum size by 6 to 7 years of age. Then it starts regressing. After 7 to 10 years, it starts regressing and almost completely disappears by puberty by 18 to 20 years. So that is the natural course of an adenoid. Relatively absent at birth and again it enlarges and again disappears by age of 18 to 20 years. So this usually there will be a small enlargement, minimum symptom, but it is usually self-limiting and it disappears by itself. But in some cases this causes problems. So that means that we will not do adenoidectomy for all cases if it causes severe problems. In other words, what are the indications? Indication you can get from the picture itself. I'll tell you. So this is the adenoids. When it enlarges, okay, what will happen? It will enlarge and it will, it enlarges. It completely, this is a nasal cavity, so it completely blocks the coina, isn't it? If it is completely closing the coina, what will happen? The patient or the child cannot breathe through nose. So there will be nasal blockade and also the voice changes, isn't it? So adenoid hypertrophy causing voice changes. What is the voice changes it is causing? It is causing the rhinal area close up. Okay. Voice abnormality. Sometimes the voice abnormality, parents or the patient will tell us frequent clearing of the throat. That is because the postnasal drip is coming and making a film over the vocal cords. So the patient has to tell like that. Frequent clearing of the throat. So that is one thing. And also because the nose is blocked, the child will breathe through mouth. So mouth breathing. In long-standing mouth breathing, what will happen? This long-standing mouth breathing causes the elongation of the middle one-third of face. And later on, going for an adenoid facies. Okay, so what is this adenoid facies? It is a typical elongated face, dull expression. And because this child is not breathing through the nose for a long time, there will be this atrophy of the ala nasae. So there will be a pinched in appearance of the nose. And this open mouth with hitched up upper lip, protruded mainly the upper medial incisors will be protruded. And there will be high arched palate. So these are the features of adenoid facies. And if the adenoid facies or the mouth breathing is going for a long time, it will lead to cardiovascular complications like core pulmonary and also pulmonary hypertension. Okay. And also sinus drainage is not happening properly. So what will happen? There will be recurrent rhinosinusitis. Okay, so that is the nasal complaints. And if it is growing again, what is this? This is a Eustachian tubal opening. So this will come and press on the Eustachian tube, causing Eustachian tube blockage. One thing is Eustachian tube block, and this Eustachian tube is connected to the middle ear, isn't it? Tympanic membrane and the external artery there. So this is connected to the anterior wall of middle ear. So one thing, it can cause a recurrent secretory otitis media, or it can cause recurrent acute otitis media, and it can also cause a chronic separative otitis media also. And also it can go for a retraction pocket formation, and also later on cholestatoma formation. Okay, so these are the symptoms it can cause in the ear because of blockage of the Eustachian tube. And because the nose is completely blocked, and the infants cannot feed, or the children will not eat properly, because at the time of swallowing there will be problems with ear, and also the pain in the ear can happen. So because the child is not eating properly, there is chance of failure to thrive also. And again, because the nose is blocked, there will be snoring and obstructive sleep apnea can happen. There is chance of dental malocclusion. Okay, dental problems, mainly dental malformation. So these are the indications of adenoid atrophy. Okay, that is the because the adenoid hypertrophy causes a blockade, because adenoid hypertrophy pushing on the Eustachian tube, because it is causing mouth breathing and related complications, and also obstructive sleep apnea. So these are the indications of adenoidectomy. The contraindication: acute infection is an absolute contraindication. You have to treat the upper respiratory infection and give minimum of 3 weeks before going for a surgery. And another one is HB, hemoglobin level anemia, hemoglobin level less than 10 g%. Correct the hemoglobin value and get it at least 10 g%. Another one is cleft palate. Both overt as well as submucous cleft palate are contraindications, but it is not an absolute contraindication. Even then, you can do adenoidectomy, but a partial adenoidectomy. That is, adenoid obstructing this choanal area you can remove, and over the cleft, adenoid tissue over the cleft is kept there, so that the later velopharyngeal insufficiency will not happen. And bleeding disorders like hemophilia and other blood dyscrasias, all are contraindication. And also epidemic of polio is an absolute contraindication. Then medical problems. like uncontrolled diabetes, hypertension, asthma, especially if you are doing in adults, they are also contraindication, and it is usually avoided at the time of menstruation in females. So indication and contraindication over. The next is preoperative evaluation, and in the preoperative evaluation, the most important is the clinical history, which is pointing towards an adenoid hypertrophy should be taken, and also history of atopy is important. Okay, especially you ask for a family history of atopy and also allergic rhinitis, that has to be well written in the history. And if there is no atopy or allergic history, it has to be mentioned in the history. In the clinical examination, a detailed examination of the nose and the ear is important. And if there is an allergy, long-standing allergy, you can see the allergic solute in the external nose. There is a crease in the external nose because of the constant rubbing of the nose. That will be visible in most of the cases of atopy. And the gold standard in the clinical examination is nasal endoscopy. Because in most of the cases, the child will not allow you to do a post-nasal examination using mirror. So, nasal endoscopy is important, especially prior to surgery. This nasal endoscopy is very important. And the Clements has graded the nasal endoscopy finding into four grades, and the Coyna. So, this is the vertical height. Okay. So, according to Clements grading, grade 1 is up to 1/3. You can divide into 1/3, another 1/3, and another 1/3. Okay. So, Clements is graded according to grade 1 is adenoid reaching up to the upper 1/3 of the vertical height of coina. And grade 1 is not an indication for surgery. Okay. And in grade 2, it reaches from 1/3 to 2/3. Reaching up to 2/3 of coina, that is grade 1, grade 2, and grade 3 is 2/3 to near complete filling. Okay, it's not complete, but it is nearly complete. So we can draw it like this, the vertical height. Still a small part is remaining, and if it is completely obstructed in the coina, it becomes grade 4. Okay, that is Clement's grading. Grade 1 is up to 1/3 of the vertical height. That is important. And grade 2 from 1/3 to 2/3 of the vertical height of coina. And grade 3, 2/3 of vertical height up to complete, near complete filling of the coina. And the complete filling of the coina is grade 4. So, obviously, grade 2, 3 and 4 will be an indication for surgery. The blood examination is also very important, especially the bleeding time and the clotting time, and also hemoglobin. Okay, the HB, total count, differential count, the platelet count, and also bleeding time and clotting time. And if you suspect any blood coagulation pathology, also go for an APDT and prothrombin time. In the pre-op evaluation, the X-ray nasopharynx is also important. And this, as I already told, this adenoids are radiologically visible by 4 to 6 months of age in all infants. But if you are seeing radiologically visible soft tissue mass filling the nasopharynx at birth, always think in terms of congenital disorders like in meningoencephalocele, because at birth this adenoids will not be visible radiologically. The next is the procedure itself. So, procedure contains anesthesia. And what is anesthesia? It is general anesthesia. And as you are doing adenoid, you can't go for a nasotracheal intubation. So, it is general anesthesia with the orotracheal intubation. And the position, it is Rose's position. And this is a position for all surgeries done in the nasopharynx, the palate, and all the also the oropharynx, that is Rose's position. What is that? R-O-S-E-S, Rose's position. patient is supine, and since the surgery is done in the nasopharynx, and if you are going for a tonsillectomy, it is in the oropharynx. So better visualization of the nasopharynx and the oropharynx should be there. For that, to make into a roses position, you have to keep a pillow under the shoulders. A pillow is kept under the shoulder, so that what will happen? There will be extension of the pillow is kept here. So a pillow or a sandbag under the shoulders, and a neck is extended, so there is chance of this head getting mobilized. So we have to keep a head ring under the head also. A head ring is kept here so that this will be the position. See, so you can open, the surgeon is standing here or sitting here, he can see the oral cavity, oropharynx and the nasopharynx of the patient very clearly. So this is the position, roses position, that is supine with extension of the neck over the chest, and by keeping a sandbag or a pillow under the shoulders, and the head is stabilized by using a head ring. That is roses position. Okay, with orotracheal intubation and patient in roses position, now we can do the adenoidectomy. There are various methods for adenoidectomy. The traditional method is the curettage, transoral curettage method, which is a blind procedure. And there are also newer techniques which are endoscopically assisted. We can see the adenoid and do the procedure. Endoscopy, microdebrider assisted adenoidectomy, or using coblators, or using suction diathermy. But the KTP laser is better avoided because it can lead to this nasopharyngeal stenosis at a later time. I explained the transoral curettage method in detail, and there are special instruments for that which is usually asked for the Viva in exam. These are the instruments. One is a Boylan Davis mouth gag. Because the patient is in rose position, you have to open the mouth and stabilize it there. So for that we use the Boylan Davis mouth gag and Ortiz tongue blade, Ruffin's bicord, Macquarie's plate, St. Clair Thompson's adenoid curette with and without guard. You can see the instruments. So after positioning, we have to open the mouth of the patient using this instrument. It is Boylan Davis mouth gag and Doty's tongue blade. Okay, Boylan Davis mouth gag and Doty's tongue blade. Right? So usually you will be asked in Viva how to assemble this. You have to know that also. So hold this in one hand and hold this part here, and this is how you have to. Here there is a locking mechanism. So press this, open the lock and keep it like this. Okay. So Boylan Davis mouth gag and Doty's tongue blade. This mouth gag, this will be pressing on the upper lip, and a locking and unlocking part, and a slit in this. You hold it like this and unlock it. Keep or slide the Doty's tongue blade into the Boylan Davis mouth gag, and after putting it or sliding it completely, lock it. So this will be on the upper lip of the patient, lying down, and you can open it, and this tongue blade will retract the tongue of the patient. So this will be inside of the oral cavity. So this Boil and dove is mouth gag and Doughty's tongue blade is introduced. Stabilized. Oral cavity opened. And if you want to do surgery, both hands should be free. For that, this Boyle and Davis mouth gag is stabilized or kept in a Drafting's bipod. Bipod, there are two. So this is stabilized in Drafting's bipod. And again, this has to be kept in a McGoran's plate. There are holes in this. So these two are the bipods. And this is McGoran's plate. So McGoran's plate is kept. The patient is lying here. I am standing on the head end of the patient. And this is kept below the neck of the patient. There are holes in McGoran's plate. It is kept below the neck of the patient on the operating table. And Boyle and Davis mouth gag is stabilized by putting it on the bipod, and the bipods are kept on the McGoran's plate, and after assembly it will be like this. Okay, so patient lying, this will open the oral cavity of the patient, and it is supported by the bipods and the McGoran's plate. Understood? So this will be the oral cavity, and we can open the oral cavity as per the requirements. This one is St. Clair Thompson's adenoid curette with guard. See, this is guard. And in exam, sometimes you will be asked to dislodge the guard. So this is a guard and this is without guard. And the assembling is also very easy. There is a slit in this. So first you put this into the slit and after that keep it. Okay, so this is guard also. So this is St. Clair Thompson's adenoid curette with guard. Okay, this is a guard. You hold the St. Clair Thompson's adenoid curette with guard like a dagger, and suppose this is the oral cavity. You introduce it into the oral cavity below the soft palate and till you reach the posterior end of septum. And once you reach the posterior end of septum, then with the sweeping movement of the wrist joint, this is a movement, this is a sweeping movement of the wrist joint, take out the or the curette the adenoid tissue. Okay, so keeping the St. Clair Thompson's adenoid curette with guard like a dagger, even if it is without guard, you have to hold it like a dagger, and by the sweeping action of the wrist joint, curette out the adenoid tissue. And while doing this with the other hand, if you are a right-handed surgeon, using the left hand, you have to flex the neck of the patient. Otherwise, there is chance of curettage or causing inflammation of the or injury to the anterior ligament of the spine, or there will be a non-traumatic subluxation of the atlantoaxial joint, and that can lead to Griessel syndrome later on. Open the mouth, then first thing is to palpate the nasopharynx, your digital palpation with your fingers. At that time, look for presence of any submucous cleft palate. Because if there is a submucous cleft palate, you have to do only a partial adenoidectomy. And the palpation is for the confirmation of the presence of adenoid. And also, you have to medialize the lateral adenoid mass. Because in the transoral curettage method, if the adenoids are present on the laterally and you are curating from the lateral side, what is the important structure in the lateral wall? It is the eustachian tube cushion. So if you curate on the eustachian tubal cushion, if there is injury to the eustachian tube cushion, there is chance of permanent stenosis and recurrent middle ear problems. So that has to be avoided. So the digital palpation is for the presence, to find out the presence of a submucous cleft palate and also medialization of the lateral adenoid tissue. And after that, take the Sinclair Thompson's adenoid curette with or without guard, and the guard is for locking the tissue inside, and also it will prevent the slippage of the tissue. Okay, you can also use adenoid curette without guards. And after completely curetting it, either through the curettage method or using any other newer technique, after complete removal, the nasopharynx should be packed with the adenoid bags. And one of the routine question asked is, how long will you keep the adenoid bag? If it is associated with tonsillectomy, the answer is till the tonsillectomy is over, you can keep the adenoid bag. If there is no associated tonsillectomy, the answer is the bags are kept more than the clotting time of the patient. Okay, and after that, the adenoid bags are removed, and again look for any bleeding, then close it and go for an extubation. Endoscopy procedures, giving a direct vision is preferred over the traditional transoral curettage technique, because all these will cause a reduced bread loss. An average bread loss with under direct vision is around 4 ml versus around 50 ml after a transoral curettage technique, which is blind procedure. So 4 ml versus a 50 ml. So definitely this is a better option and this is preferred, and never go for a KTP because the reason I have already explained. Never do with a KTP laser. The postoperative care, immediately after extubation, the patient is kept in a coma position or tonsil position, that is turned to one side with the head low, so that aspiration is avoided. And also constant monitoring of the pulse, respiration and blood pressure, at least for 6 hours, that is the time for complete recovery from anesthesia. And also look for the phase of or the frequency of swallowing. If there is more frequency or increased frequency of swallowing, think of a bleeding either from the nasopharynx or from the oropharynx, and look for bleeding from the nose also. And once the patient is completely out of anesthesia, the ice cold feeds can be started, and advised to rinse the mouth at least 3 to 4 times a day, and also wash the mouth thoroughly after each feed. Usually a daycare surgery, so from the after 24 hours, the normal feeds can be started, but low spicy diet. And patient is asked to come back if there is any signs of fresh bleeding, either from the nose or from the mouth. Or otherwise, the first follow-up is after 5 to 7 days. And also, you can start on analgesics, anti-inflammatory, and also antibiotics can be started. Usually the child or the patient will complain of an earache, which is due to glossopharyngeal neuralgia in the postoperative period, and it is usually relieved with the analgesics. The complications are important, and also the method to tackle them. And this complication, we can divide it into immediate and delayed complication. And the immediate again divided into due to anesthesia and due to surgery. Due to anesthesia, what are the complications that can happen? Usually the allergy to anesthetic drugs, anaphylaxis or cardiac arrest, difficult extubation, also difficult intubation and difficult extubation, edema of the larynx, all will come under that. That part this anesthetist will look after. And during surgery, the commonest complication that can happen in any surgery is bleeding. And primary bleeding is the bleeding happening at the time of surgery. And in the case of adenoid, the cause of bleeding is, in most of the cases, it is the remnant adenoid, that is adenoid remaining after removal, that is due to incomplete removal. So if it is a reason for bleeding, it should be removed. And this is more common in case of a blind procedure, transoral curettage method. That should be looked after, and if any adenoid tissue remaining, that should be removed. And again, if it is bleeding, can be used cauterized with an electrocautery. And this reactionary hemorrhage is bleeding happening after recovery from anesthesia in the first course. Again, it should be looked after, and the bleeding points are cauterized in case of adenoidectomy. And there is answer of injury to the dentures, that is very common, especially while putting the mouth gag. There is chance of injury to the teeth, and preoperatively you have to look for any loose tooth. If present, it should be removed before surgery. And also, if you are not looking into that, there is a chance of accidental ingestion of the dentures. That will be a grave situation in way. Chance of edema to the tongue, palate, and also the nasopharynx. And the delayed complications are again secondary hemorrhage. It is more commonly seen with a tonsillectomy rather than adenoidectomy. Still, the secondary hemorrhage is due to infection. If so, the child or the patient should be admitted and IV antibiotics started and supportive measures started. And still there is bleeding, take to the operation theatre and look for any bleeding point. And if they are present, it should be cauterized. And again, infection is another chance. Sepsis can happen. And what is this Griessel syndrome? That is rare, but it is a common short note. Griessel syndrome is a non-traumatic subluxation of the atlantoaxial joint. We know that these adenoids are situated at the junction of roof and the posterior wall. That is over the atlantoaxial joint. So, while curating, this mainly happens, or this Griessel syndrome happens during a transoral blind curettage technique. So while curating, there is chance of injury to the anterior ligament of spine and later, and also going for a subluxation of the atlantoaxial joint. And this usually presents, the child or the patient presents with a torticollis usually after 6 to 10 days after surgery. If you are suspecting a Griessel syndrome, admit the patient and confirm it by doing a CT scan of the cervical spine. And this most chance of a Griessel syndrome in case of Down syndrome. So in that cases, you should be more vigilant. And the pulmonary complications like atelectasis and lung abscess happen if there is aspiration at the time of surgery. And scarring of the nasopharynx and also velopharyngeal insufficiency can happen. And if there is a submucous cleft palate, as I already told, go for a partial adenoidectomy. And if there is a difficulty in swallowing, if the child is complaining of difficulty in swallowing, or there is change in the voice of the patient, then think in terms of velopharyngeal insufficiency. And there is also chance of recurrence of adenoid, especially in case of a transoral curettage technique. And the recurrence is very rare after this newer endoscopy technique, which is done under direct vision, and so that is a preferred method nowadays. Along with the immediate complication, I forgot to tell the airway obstruction that can happen by a retained nasal swab, nasopharyngeal pack, or due to nasopharyngeal breadcrumb. So it is mandatory that if you are using nasopharyngeal packs before removing the gag, before removing the Boyle and Davis mouth gag and Doty's tongue blade, you have to count the number of nasopharyngeal packs used and confirm that it is removed from the nasopharynx. And otherwise, there is high chance of an airway obstruction and also the death of the patient. And also, look for any nasopharyngeal blood clot present, and if so, it should be removed before removing the gag and extubating the patient. So I have explained about the adenoidectomy in detail, the indications, contraindication, preoperative evaluation, procedure, postoperative care and complications. If any doubt, ask in the comment box. Thank you.